Do you remember when I tried to control ferro fluid with my Pizzeball coils? Yeah, it didn't work that well. This idea actually kicked off when the Applied Procrastination guys reached out to me to try and remove all the wires in their ferrofluid display. But I didn't think it was possible because my PCB coils were too weak. But a few months ago I created a PCB electromagnet which was way more efficient. So I shipped some samples to Cement to test it with their ferrofluid display and it didn't work. Time to elevate things. My first idea was to swap things around and have a magnet sandwiched between the ferrofluid and the PCB. There would be a coil array that could move the magnet in the X and Y direction, which as a result moves the ferrofluid. There was one problem. Only one magnet can be used because otherwise the magnets will start interacting with each other. Simon wasn't very happy with this because it would limit the resolution of his display. So we reverted back to the idea of attracting ferrofluid with the PCB coil.
Hey Carl, your flexible PCB coils are really thin, so it's actually possible to stack them on top of each other to increase the number of turns. Wouldn't that increase the magnetic field strength?
This is a question I get asked a lot. Can you stack two PCB coils to create a stronger magnetic field? To test this out, I connected two coils in parallel and the magnetic field does improve, but the temperature becomes way too hot. This has to do with the fact that the coils have a series resistance, so connecting two coils in parallel would result in a drop in resistance, which means more current pass through the coil, increasing the magnetic field but also raising the temperature. Connecting them in series would result in a higher resistance, which lowers the current and thus lowering the magnetic field strength. Theoretically, by adding more turns, the beat should increase. But in practice, this also increases the series resistance, which doesn't allow that to happen. Now, there is another way how we could add more turns without affecting the series resistance, and that is by increasing the copper thickness. I have never experimented with using thicker copper layers. Flexar currently uses 0.5 ounce thick copper. So imagine how much more turns we could fit with like 5 ohms. It was very important that the area of the coil doesn't get larger than what it is right now, so that if it works, it doesn't affect the resolution of the display. This means that any new turns we're going to fit needs to be added to new layers. I asked my PCB manufacturer more details about copper thickness, and the main limitation here is that the thicker the copper, the wider the track has to be. So given that my Flexar actuator has only 4mm track width and clearance, it can only be manufactured with 1 ounce thick copper. Something like 2 ounce would require a width and clearance of 8mm.
I ran some simulations to estimate how much more turns could fit for the same resistance value, and these are the results I got. To keep the same area, we need to fit these new turns in more layers.
So I'm going to design two new PCBs, and one of them is going to be my first thread layer board.
Now, I wasn't completely confident with my track resistance simulation, so for the 4-layer coil, I made this test board that have multiple coils with different turns. It is divided into 4 coil groups that have different variables like copper fills and a steel stiffener. I took a similar approach for the 12-layer coil design, making 2 coils, one with polygon pores and one without. I also left the bottom vias untented, which would allow me to bypass layers in case the resistance is higher. Both of these PCBs were designed using the latest version of Altium Designer. In my opinion, this is the most polished and high-end PCB design software. It is what all the big tech giants use to design electronics, and although it's a professional tool, it still manages to make it really easy for everyone to learn how to develop their own circuits. Click the link in my description to get access for a free trial of Altium Designer and get 30% off your license. Thank you PCBWay for sponsoring my new PCB coils. Let's start by testing the 12-layer coil. This board was manufactured with a 2mm thickness. The coil's inductance was increased to 255 microhenries because of the new extra turns, but its resistance was a little bit smaller than my initial 20 ohms target, so at a constant 5 volts the coils was drawing more current. I was afraid that this would make it get too hot, but it still managed to fit with my current Flexar's temperature range. As you can see in this test, the exposed copper sample managed to keep it a little cooler without there being any effects to its magnetic field strength. This means that the 12-layer coil is 5 times stronger than my 2-layer coil, which makes it the strongest PCB actuator I ever made. And remember that this is still without steel. Adding this back core increases the magnetic field to 16 millitesla. which means that this could work much better with ferrofluid. But before we jump into ferrofluid testing, let's test the four layer coils. I split the board into two so that first I can measure the parameters of the non-stiffener area and started eliminating the ones that got too hot, and the samples got within range. Compared to my two-layer coil, their magnetic field was around twice as strong. But the stiffener samples didn't improve, so I added my thicker steel plate and made it go up to 7 mTa.
I'm very impressed with the performance of this four-layer coil because I think it can improve a lot of my projects. But when it comes to ferrofluid control, it didn't work that well.
The best result I was getting was with the 12-layer coil, but the ferrofluid in this jar wasn't that liquidy, and the glass also had some thicker areas. So I ordered some better quality ferrofluid and tested it in a tin petri dish.
My new PCB electromagnet managed to attract a small bubble of ferrofluid. But here's when Simon suggested something that changed everything. The way this works is by biasing the core with a magnet. I'm not sure if this is considered cheating, but it worked very well with my setup. So let's forget about this magnet biasing idea and see how this would compare to an off-the-shelf electromagnet.
Well, the electromagnets create a much larger bubble. At 5 volts, they generate a magnetic field of around 20 mTa, which to be fair isn't that larger than my 12-layer PCB electromagnet, but these guys can be powered with 12 volts, which means that they are much more powerful. 12 volts? No. Okay, going back to 5 volts.
I tried to power my coil with 12 volts just to see what happens, and the magnetic field got pumped up to 30 mTa, which created a much stronger bubble. But as you're probably guessing, the heat is a problem here. Now, this doesn't mean that you cannot power it with 12 volts. Simon created this music visualizer that supplies short period of 12 volts pulses, which still kept the coil at low temperatures. These are some 12 volts PWM tests I've made, which exclude the magnet biasing. So can we use these PCB electromagnets to make a full ferrofluid display? To answer this question, we need to use a much more buoyant ferrofluid tank, which the Applied Procrastination guys have. So go over to their channel and watch their video.